I would like to present a few more examples of quotient constructions which are useful in algebraic topology. Before that, let me make one remark. Suppose you have a map from Z1 to Z2, which is a homeomorphism. Similarly, another homeomorphism from Y1 to Y2. X1 is a subspace of Z1, X2 is a subset of Z2, and under phi, X1 goes to X2. Okay, so I am doing adjunction space constructions over Z1, Y1 and over X1, similarly Z2, Y2 and X2 through maps F1 and F2. I assume that F2 is exactly equal to, you start with X2, come to X1 via phi inverse, and then take F1, then go back via psi. Okay, if you have this data, okay, then what you have is a disjoint union Z1 and Y1 to disjoint union Z2, Y2, you have a homeomorphism phi disjoint union psi. I mean the patch up of these two homeomorphisms because they are disjoint union. But now, because of this relation that F2 is precisely F composite psi composite F inverse, this compatibility. Whatever you do identifications here, corresponding identifications will take place here. Therefore, under this the homeomorphism from phi disjoint in psi, you get a homeomorphism. First of all, you get a map, which is bijective, from the adjunction space F1 to adjunction space F2. Okay. Once this is told, then the verification is totally obvious. First of all, you should see that there is a set theoretic map, which is bijection. Continuity of this one will be totally obvious because the corresponding functions are continuous on the mother spaces. Okay. So similarly, if you take inverses, that map will be from Z2 disjoint in Y2 to Z1 disjoint in Y1. Same thing will apply. So inverse will be also continuous. So this is the topological invariance of adjunction space. Later on, we will see similar version for homotopy invariance of adjunction spaces, which will require less hypothesis than for homeomorphism. In particular, we may say that homeomorphism type of the adjunction spaces depends on the ambient homeomorphism class of the adjoining maps. If the maps F from X to Y or and X1 to Y1 to X2 to Y2, they are just related by homeomorphism, that is not enough. The homeomorphism should take place on the domain at the top level, namely Z1 to Z2, and corresponding homeomorphism Y1 to Y2, so that the two maps are correspond under those homeomorphisms. That's the ambient homeomorphism class. So here is another construction now, which is a slight modification of the mapping cylinder. Okay. Remember that mapping cylinder of a function f from x to y was defined as quotient space of x cross 0, 1 interval disjoint union y by the relation that x comma 1 is identified with fx. Okay. So you can think of this as adjunction space of x cross I disjoint in y. Y are the map which is defined on x cross 1 to y. So it is an adjunction space. You can, this we have seen. Instead of that, instead of x cross I, you take the cone, namely x cross 0 is collapsed to a single point. Then x cross, x itself is identified with x cross 1 as a subspace. So you can think of y as defined on a subspace of this z, this cx, and then take the adjunction space. That is called the mapping cone of f, which is nothing but, another way of looking at it is the quotient of the mapping cylinder in which the first coordinate x cross 0 is also identified to single point. Okay. So recall that x here is usually identified with x cross 1, okay, in the mapping cone, but in the cone itself. But when you go to mapping cone, okay, this x cross 1 also is not a subspace. You will have to take some x cross half or some other t, any x cross t not equal to 0 or 1. Those will be the copies of them. Whereas y is always a subspace of this mapping cone. Okay. The image of x cross 1 in CF itself may not be homeomorphic to x, but there are other copies of x, namely x cross t where t is not equal to 0 or 1. Okay. So this is the modification. So don't make the confusion that x cross 1 is still a subspace of this mapping cone of the function f. All right. So there are various this kind of constructions. The next construction is also very useful, which is just doubling the cone. The cone is defined as quotient of x cross I, right, wherein you have identified x cross 0 to a single point. This time what we will do, we will take two copies. So what we will do, we will take instead of x cross I, you take x cross minus 1 to plus 1. To begin with, you have a double space here. Now you identify both the end axis, x cross minus 1 as well as x cross 1 to two different points, single points. Okay, so this is the picture. You have x here and x cross minus 1 to plus 1 like this, the cylinder. The x cross 1 goes to a single point here. X cross minus 1 comes to a single point. So this is called the suspension of x. There is another terminology here, what are called as reduced surface suspensions, which I am not going to define right now. Okay. That will be needed when you are deep into the homotopy theory. Right now, you don't need it. So in the light of that, these are called unreduced suspensions. Okay. For example, suppose x is a single point, then what is the suspension of x? It is no identification at all. You have to take x cross minus 1 plus 1, which is just minus 1 plus 1, homeomorphic to minus 1 plus 1. Right? So the cone over single point was the interval. Similarly, the suspension over a single point is also an interval. More interesting things happen. Just take two points. A space with two points and a discrete space. is a discrete topology, not an indiscrete topology. Then what will be the suspension? Now X cross I will consist of disjoint union of two copies of the interval, right? One endpoint consists of minus one cross two points. The other one will be another plus one cross two points. These two things are identified to single points. So what you get is like a diamond shape now, which is nothing but up to homeomorphism, which is circle, right? So the two-point space can be thought of as S naught, okay, minus one plus one, cross minus one plus one, then identify the endpoints of this, then you get the circle. Actually, you better identify it as a diamond shape, but diamond shape is also homeomorphic to circle. Okay. So the suspension of S naught is S1. What happens to suspension of S1? Here is a picture. Forget about the shaded part. This picture, if you take just the boundary, that is a circle. When you take the suspension, what is this space? It is nothing but union of two copies of disks, because the cone over circle is a disk identified along the common circle, the base. So which will be nothing but the two sphere. Suspension of a one sphere is a two sphere. Exactly same argument will tell you suspension of any n sphere is n plus one sphere. When I say is n plus one sphere, I just mean homeomorphic. That's all. You can directly write down a neat homeomorphism. If you use cos theta, sin theta and so on, it will become neat instead of the corners here. It will become round. Okay, there is a nice description of this suspension, just like the cone, at the function level. Namely, suppose you start with a function from x to y, and s of x, s of y are the suspensions. Then there will be sf from sx to sy, just defined by sf of a class xt goes to the class of fx and t. To begin with, if you don't take class here, this is a map at the level of x cross minus 1 plus 1 to y cross minus 1 plus 1, which is just f cross identity. Whatever is identified in the domain, okay, all of them go to the same points which get identified. Therefore, this map will factor down to give you a continuous function at the suspension level. The argument similar you have seen, cx to cy, cf, whenever x is a continuous function from x to y. It is similar to this one. So you have suspension level. And this suspension has all those typical properties. If you take x to x identity, s of identity is the identity function of the suspension sx. And if you have x to y and y to z, another function g, then if you take g composite f and then s of that, namely suspension of that, that will be suspension of g composite suspension of f. Because all those things are happening in the first coordinate here. G composite F is, okay, G composite F, that's all. Okay, the T coordinates do not disturb the functoriality, the functional compositions on the first coordinate here. Okay. Now, here are a few observations which I will leave to you to think about it. I will go through them slowly. You think about it. Finally, you have to come up with a proof. Okay. A sex can be obtained by gluing two copies of CX, the cone, which you can write it as C plus X and C minus X, along X, which is X cross 1, identified. And a homeomorphism type is, the homeomorphism type is independent of gluing homeomorphism F from X to X. You can take any homeomorphism and identify C plus with C minus of X. The resulting space always homeomorphic to SX. Construction of SX is functorial property. This I already explained. What is the meaning of this sentence? If X is a homeomorphism, then SF will be also a homeomorphism. If G is the inverse, then SF inverse will be SG. Okay. The last thing is, which also I have explained. Now you have to write down some rigorous proof of this, that's all. The suspension of SN is one dimension higher sphere, namely SN plus 1. To help this one, I am giving you the topological result here, namely, if we glue two copies of n-dimensional disks along their boundary, okay, via a homeomorphism, the resulting space is homeomorphic to n-dimensional sphere. Okay, it's like gluing, simplest case, n equal to 1, you take two intervals, closed intervals, identify the boundaries by a homeomorphism from one to the other, namely a bijection. A goes to A prime, B goes to B prime, identify what you get to circle. So this generalizes to all the dimension Dn. Okay, so that is how S of Sn becomes Sn plus 1. If you do this one, then there's no exercise here. This is not exercise. So this is like that. Because you would have done this exercise already. And you would have also known that the cone over the sphere, okay, is a disk of one dimension higher. If you put them together, you'll get this one. Okay? So now the exercise is to write down the details for each of them. Next, I'll take one more example. This is called topological join. This is actually a far more generalized than those suspension and so on. You can get suspension as a special case of this one, you will see. Okay. So let X and Y be two non-empty topological spaces. If empty space, the product is empty and so on, so you don't want to get into that. We define the topological join X star Y of X and Y to be the quotient space of X cross I cross Y. Okay? So it is not just X cross I, it's not I cross I, it is X cross I cross Y. If both X and Y are I, then this would be a cube, I cross I cross I. Okay? That is the simplest picture you will have. All right, now what I am going to identify, each x1, 1 and y, I mean when this t parameter is 1, will be identified with x2, comma 1, comma y. The third coordinate must be the same. Then first coordinate, any arbitrary x, they are all identified as single point. For each y, this is what. So at one end, I am killing the identifying the x to a single point for each y. Okay, you can write x cross y cross 1, right? Instead of x cross 1 cross y. In that, each for each y, the x is identified single point. So that is one thing. Same thing I want to do the other way around. At 0, for each fixed x, I identify y1 to y2 for all y1 and y2. X is the same. So for every x in x and y1 and y2 in y. Okay. I started non-empty spaces. If y is empty, then you have defined what is x cross y. So if you take product, then it will be empty. So you don't do that. You would like to have x star y as x itself. Okay. Maybe you would like to define it as empty, that may be better. I'm not very sure of this one. Okay, if you need some change, you can define it like this. Okay? Intuitively, what is this topological join? It, x cross I cross y. It has union of lines parameterized by x comma y. This is just line segment. Union of lines parameterized by x comma y. Okay. But when you identify all the x to a single point, what you have is from a single y to that space, you have a line segment. Similarly, from y2 to you have a line segment. And so on. So I will let you know example with a better example. Okay, here this is not an example, this is trying to explain this in the abstract sense only. So what it is look at the class, some x, some y. Okay. So t is never identified to anything. So as t runs from 0 to 1, you will get a line. This line you can think of is as starting at x and ending at y. In other words, you see, in abstract sense, it is creating lines from x to y. In the cone, what it has created, an extra point was taken, and there was lines from every point of x to that extra point. Right, that is the cone. Here, what I have done, here we do, instead of just one extra point, a space is already given. X is given, another space is given. Now, for each point of y, you draw a line from x to y. Where do you draw? That's the point. So it is not happening in any Rn or Euclidean space or any vector space. It is abstractly happening. Okay, that is why you take x cross I cross y and do the identification. Okay. So to justify this explanation, let me give you a simple example. There's a typo here. Start with x to be a line segment PQ and y to be another line segment UV. Okay. Denote two line segments in R3, x equal to PQ, this is okay, which are skewed. The two segments must be not intersecting, non-parallel. That is called as skew lines. So how to ensure that? There are many ways of ensuring it. Namely, you can look at, fix one point as the origin, then look at Q minus P, U minus P and V minus P. So you get three vectors. These three vectors must be independent. So that will ensure that P minus Q and U minus V are not parallel vectors. So line segments are not parallel. Neither they intersect, because if they intersect, there will be only two vectors here. Okay. The third vector will be already one of the independent, either zero or one of difference of these two, sum of these two, that's all. Okay. So the topological join of this X and Y, the two line segments, which are skew, is nothing but the convex hull of this. Take the convex hull of all these four points, namely what is called a tetrahedron. The convex hull of three independent points would have been a triangle. Okay. So there is a fourth point which is not in that plane. So what you get is a tetrahedron, which is the same thing as take arbitrary point in PQ from P to Q, join it to some arbitrary point in U and V, okay, between U and V. Take the collection of all these. So that will be the join of X and Y. It is also equal to the convex hull of P, Q, U, V, which is a tetrahedron. So, in some sense, the join is, you know, generalizing even the construction of convex hulls. Okay? Now we can do some elementary algebra of sets on this star. The star is join, X star Y. X star Y contains both X and Y as subspaces. Only at one point, the points of X are identified, at namely when the T coordinate is one. Similarly, when T coordinate is zero, points of Y are identified. If you take T coordinate not equal to zero, the whole X cross Y will be there. So both X and Y are subspaces. In fact, to take X going to X, comma 0, comma Y, there is no identification of X here. The Y coordinates gets identified. So this is a nice copy of X on the zeroth face. Similarly, Y going to any X, comma 1, comma Y would be a inclusion of Y. Okay, X, comma 1, comma Y. These are subspaces of X star Y. Okay, just similar to the base of the cone or suspension and so on. The topological join is both commutative and associative. What is the meaning of this? Up to homeomorphism, X star Y is same thing as Y star X. So this follows by the commutativity of the product. X cross Y is homeomorphic to Y cross X. Okay. Similarly, it is associative. X star Y bracket star Z is same thing as X star Y star Z. All that you have to do is first have this law in the product space. X cross I cross Y cross I cross Z. You put the bracket wherever you like. So when you take quotient space, that is the X star Y star Z or X star Y star Z. But the identifications are exactly same, whether you do it this way or this way. Therefore, these two spaces are homeomorphic. Okay, similarly, this is easier, this is commutative. Okay, Suppose X is a singleton space. Then what I have? I have X cross I cross a single point, which is X cross I. And then I make identification. Okay. So what is this? At zero, I am defining all the X to be single point. Right? So that will become like a core. When I come to one, there is already only one point there. Right? Why there is no identification? All the points of Y should be identified, but there is no identification. Therefore, this is just the cone. Okay? So this is one of the reasons why we, even if a single point, it is not X. The operation is not X, it is CX. So if you want an operation to have identity, then you have to take Y as empty set. That is one of the reasons why I have taken. If Y is empty, then you define X star empty space as X. This is just a definition. It doesn't follow logically. Because if you take the product space with an empty set, it's empty already. Okay. So what we know is if you take one of the things as single point, then this is the cone. If you take one of them at two points, then what you get is S naught or S naught star X. By definition, these are two points. This will be exactly same as the suspension. Okay. So with the kind of explanation I have given, it should be clear that why this is true. S naught cross I cross X will consist of two copies of X cross I. When you perform identifications around X, we'll get two cones. And they'll get identified because of identifications for S naught. Okay, so you get S naught cross star X is SX. The special cases of this, I already told you, once it is SX, S of S naught, so S naught star S naught. We discussed this. What is this? It is S of S naught, which is S1. And S naught of S1, which is nothing but S of S1, which is S2 and so on, right? So S naught of S naught, S naught star of S naught is homeomorphic of S1. Inductively, we can show that Sn star Sm is homeomorphic to S of n plus m plus 1. All right? You can write Sn star Sm as inductively S naught star Sn minus 1 here star with Sm. Okay, by associativity, you take the first this star, that will be equal to by induction S of n plus m. But now I am taking S naught of that. By this, S naught of that will be one more dimension higher, namely S n plus m plus 1. The induction starts at n equal to m equal to 0. Okay. So that is a proof. Okay, so we can stop here.